Okay, so let's take a look at another problem that's related to chapter six. And so this is a stripping process, and please try to read this problem and work it on your own before watching this screencast. Let's start by taking a look at a simple process flow diagram. What we have happening here is we have air coming in, and we need to know how much air we need in order to perform this separation for a given amount of water, and I've specified a water flow rate here of 1 mole of water. All right, so we're assuming 1 mole of water is our basis, and we need to determine n dot air. All right, we know that for each mole of water that we have 5 × 10⁻⁴ moles of contaminant that I'll call C. All right, and then we know that some of that contaminant will exit in the vapor stream. We're given a Henry's law constant for that, and some of the contaminant will exit in the still in the liquid stream. But we're told that we're going to remove 95% of the contaminant from the liquid stream. Okay, so that tells us that we should be able to multiply that number by 0.05, and that's how much is basically left in the liquid stream. Okay, so let's start by doing a simple balance on the contaminant. Okay, we have 5 × 10⁻⁴ moles coming in on a based on our 1 mole basis of the liquid stream, and this is equal to the fraction in the liquid phase coming out times n dot w plus the fraction in the vapor phase coming out times n dot vapor out. All right, so we're going to need some relationships to know how much is in the liquid and the vapor. But the assumption that we're going to make is that the molar flow rate of the liquid stays constant. All right, so n dot w we're going to assume is still 1 mole. All right, and so that simplifies our treatment. The reason we're going to make that assumption is that the, and so this is, I'm sorry, this should be n dot w out. All right, the reason we make the assumption that liquid flow rate doesn't change is really for two reasons. First of all, we do have contaminant leaving the liquid phase and entering the vapor phase, and that can affect the flow rate of the liquid stream. That can cause it to decrease. But we expect that to be a pretty small effect, especially because the contaminant has such a small concentration that even if we remove all of the contaminant from the liquid stream, it has a negligible effect on our 1 mole. All right, we also expect that some water will actually vaporize in this process and enter the airstream since the air comes in dry. All right, we expect that that's the case. But we're going to make the assumption for now that that is also negligible, that it's not going to be very much water coming out, and we'll evaluate how good that assumption was at the end of this problem. Okay, and so we know that this number is equal to 5% of what came in because we have 95% being removed from the liquid phase. And so 0.05 times 5 × 10⁻⁴ is what's in that stream. And therefore, in this stream, we have 0.95 × 10⁻⁴. So I can just write down that YC times n dot vapor out is equal to 0.95 times 5 × 10⁻⁴ moles. All right, so that's how many moles exit in the vapor stream. But we still need to determine YC and n dot vape out. We're going to assume in this problem, since we've already assumed that ne a negligible amount of water and contaminant enter the airstream, that n dot vape out is going to be equal to n dot air in. And again, we'll evaluate that assumption at the end to see how valid it is. All right, but it should be pretty valid. All right, and so n dot air is what we're going to solve for, and we can replace that with the n dot vape out. All right, but we still need to solve for YC, and to do that, we'll use Henry's law because we're dealing with low concentrations. And so YC times P is equal to XC times HC, which is our Henry's law constant. Our only unknown here is actually YC, so we can plug this in. YC times the pressure, which is 5 bar, right, is equal to XC, which is 0.05 times 5 × 10⁻⁴, which is our mole fraction, so 5 × 10⁻⁴ moles over 1 mole of water, and our HC value is 2.5 bar. And so I'll take this to the next page. We can just solve for YC, and YC should come out to be 1.25 × 10⁻⁵ for our mole fraction. All right, so that's a pretty low number, it seems like, not a very high mole fraction of our contaminant. And so as we'll see, that actually is going to lead to needing a very high flow rate of air. And so now we can go back to our balance equations. Now we have YC. All right, we can plug that value of YC in right here. And so we have what the value of this is. It's 0.05 times 5 times 10 to the minus 4. That's equal to 5 times 10 to the minus 4 moles on this side. We just solved for YC. It's 1.25 times 10 to the minus 5. And then our only unknown remaining is this n dot vape out, which we've said is equal to the amount of air that we are feeding under our assumptions. And so we can solve for that last unknown after plugging in YC, and we end up getting a value for n dot air, 38 moles per 1 mole of water, of contaminated water fed. All right, so we see that we have to feed much more air than water, and that's a consequence of this relatively low mole fraction that we have in the air. So it would be desirable, if we could, to increase the Henry's constant so that we get a higher mole fraction. And to do that, what we'd probably need to do is increase the temperature of our process above 20 degrees. All right, now we made the assumption in this problem that the contaminant going into the air phase doesn't really affect the overall flow rates of the liquid versus the vapor stream, that those are unchanged. And that's a very good assumption, that you're talking about 5 times 10 to the minus 4 moles versus 1 mole and versus 38 moles. And so 5 times 10 to the minus 4 is well below that kind of change in the number of moles is a very tiny fraction. And it's much less, for example, than the likely uncertainty in our Henry's law constant. So that's a very good assumption. All right, the assumption that is less of a good assumption, but still turns out to be an excellent one, all right, is the assumption that no water or actually leaves the water stream, or rather that the amount of water that goes into the air is effectively negligible. All right, what if we didn't want to assume that? So let's take a look at relaxing some of our assumptions. So what if some of the water evaporates? How do we, which it will, of course, maybe a better question is, how will that affect our solution? Okay, and so we can also, of course, not treat the flow rates of the water and vapor streams as a constant. So let's do a water balance, right? N, so for water, I will again say that N is equal to out overall, and we'll have 1 mole of water coming in, right? And all of the liquid stream going out, right, will still be water, but now we might have some mole fraction of water in the vapor phase times N dot of the vapor phase coming out, right? So we have water that's able to exit both in the liquid stream, right? And that will be almost entirely water, except for that very tiny fraction of contaminant, which we've already said is negligible. We'll also have some water vapor exiting in the vapor stream. So we have water coming out in both of these streams. We can also do a balance on air. And so the stream coming in is pure air, and we're going to call that N dot air. We've just determined that it should be around 38 moles based on our assumptions. All right, and that will be equal to 1 minus YW. And then if we want, even though this is a very small number we've already determined, minus YC, which is just 1.25 times 10 to the minus 5, times the flow rate of air out. All right, so that would be the mole fraction of the actual air times the flow rate of vapor out. All right, and we have those two balances. We've introduced additional unknowns, though. So now we don't know N dot out of the vapor, and we also don't know YW, right, based on this kind of approach. So we've introduced a couple of new equations, but now we have three new unknowns, right? So we need one more equation, and the equation that we need is based on Raoult's law, that we need to determine the mole fraction of water in the vapor phase. And so we can write the standard Raoult's law formula, right? And here, what we're solving for is YW. We know that XW is equal to 1. We know that the pressure is equal to 5 bar. We can look up the saturation pressure for water at 20 degrees C in the back of our textbook, and then we can solve for YW. And what we'll see is that YW is on the order of a few percent, and that will affect our answer by a very small percentage if you propagate that through. All right, but the amount, the air flow rate is so high, it's 38 moles, that even if you take, it's around 38 moles, I should say, it's going to be of that order of magnitude because our assumptions aren't that bad for sure. All right, And YW is on the order of a few percent. And so we expect that the overall flow rate will only change by a few moles from that 38. So if we actually look up the vapor pressure of water at 20 degrees C, and we see that it is around 0.025 bar, looking things up in the back of the textbook. And so that means that YW is equal to 5.1 times 10 to the minus 3. And so if we go look at what effect that has on the airflow rate, it really is negligible, right? That's a very tiny fraction. And we'll see that if we plug it in, 5.1 times 10 to the minus 3 times 38, right, that is a relatively small number compared to 1 mole. And so our assumption was pretty good that this is constant. But if that wasn't a good assumption, then we can take all of our equations that we had on the previous slide. So our two equations here, our balance on C, our Henry's law balance, our two balances here, and our Raoult's law balance, and we'd have five equations in terms of five unknowns, and we could just solve all of those if we didn't want to make the assumptions that we've made. But what we would see is that it really is a negligible difference in terms of the 38 moles that we calculated here.